Being Human, Chasers, by Mark Michalowski, read by Russell Tovey. Paris, New Year's Eve, 1951.
Crowds. Don't you just love them? All that warmth and noise and flesh and blood. And where better to see the New Year in than on the Champs-Élysées, swimming in a sea of humanity, a shark cruising for a meal. Or maybe just a light snack. Snacking my way through them all, flashing a smile. Bonjour, bon ami. A wink, and a deep breath in. Tasting the air like a snake with its tongue, and then moving on. It's too soon to bring this night to an end. I'm here for a buffet, not a sit-down meal. But first, I want to smell the dishes, get my juices flowing. Check out what's on the menu. Okay, enough culinary metaphors. I like the one with the shark better. But then I would, wouldn't I? I'm not a chef in some poncy restaurant sampling the ingredients just enough to know what they'll bring to the final dish. I'm here to eat. I'm looking for good old-fashioned meat and two veg, not some miniature concoction served on an oversized plate. Food that I can get my teeth into. Ha, I'm back to the culinary thing again, aren't I? Maybe that's my subconscious telling me I should have been a chef and not what I am. Not that it's exactly a career choice. Not that the two are mutually exclusive. I heard about one vampire. There I said it, the V-word, like so many of us seem to avoid at every opportunity. Vampire. Vampire, vampire, vampire. Who approached his kills like a chef. Italian, as it turned out. Better not tell the Frenchies. They'd hate that, wouldn't they? He's always organized multiple kills, picking the victims for their unique qualities, blending them in his head, and no doubt in his mouth, to create something special, something marvelous. Nah, that's not me. Don't get me wrong, I can't be fussy about who I kill. Well, I'm attractive enough to be able to pick and choose. Sometimes I pity the ones who've achieved nirvana when they're old, stuck like that, never changing, always being old. Wonder if it rankles with them. I like to think on the few occasions that I do my duty and bring another one into the fold, that I'm doing it humanely. The younger, prettier ones. The ones that have so much more to gain from immortality. It was lucky it happened to me when it did, isn't it? Imagine all the skulking around and seediness it must take to drink vibrant young blood when you have the face of a 70-year-old. But there are fewer and fewer of them about, strange as that might seem. Although I think the war has balanced that one up a bit, hasn't it? You don't see too many young men in the streets, more single young women. I think the old ones are just that bit easier to kill, to stake, behead, whatever, than us youngsters. Physically younger, obviously. You can never tell the age of the mind behind a vampire's eyes, trust me. And as more of us convert younger, sexier, attractive ones, and the olders are slowly dying off, we are truly becoming the beautiful people. And talking to beautiful people. Now, she's nice. Her there, looking around, checking a watch. 11:30. Still half an hour to go until midnight, but the Champs-Élysées is absolutely packed. From side to side, as far down as I can see without standing on something. There's a slight natural dip to it that means if you stand on your toes, you get a great view. A thick carpet of humanity, all the way from the Eiffel Tower down to the Arc de Triomphe. Oh boy, a deep breath in, and it's like the best smell ever. I don't know if it's pheromones or sweat or breath or just carbon dioxide, or if it's something weird and supernatural. I can't even describe it. It's like a whole new scent, like a new colour in the rainbow. How do you describe that to someone? But yes, she's nice, waiting for friends, wrapped up in a big rough-looking coat, maybe a soldier's coat. Probably a genuine one, thinking about it. Maybe she's waiting for a man. Maybe just friends. I like the beret. That is so French. Blonde curls. Cute little nose. Now she's cupping her hands together and blowing onto them. She sees me looking and I smile and shrug myself into a isn't it cold posture and she smiles back. Then she looks away sharply. Like she thinks she's doing something wrong. but I keep my eyes on her. And after she's made a very deliberate effort to scan the crowd, she glances back at me. I hold up the gloves that I've just taken from my pocket and grin. And then, hoping my smile doesn't seem too shark-like, I launch myself through the river of humanity that surrounds me, on course for my supper. Predator and prey.
Chapter 1
Kaz, said Mitchell. Standing in the street under a rainbow umbrella despite the complete and total absence of rain was Kaz. Her face was flushed and she looked as if she'd been running. Kaz did a funny little dance as she struggled to catch her breath and said something that sounded like, jaw.
Jaw, echoed Mitchell.
George,
said Kaz, more clearly this time.
Mitchell, beamed Mitchell.
No, George. Where is he?
Said Kaz.
Need to see George. He's...
Mitchell watched her take another big, gulping breath.
George is going to be a daddy,
she told him. Mitchell boggled. He took a step back and waved her in. She struggled with the umbrella. Annie rolled her eyes as the new arrival entered the house. Kaz, one of George's lesbian friends. The lesbian friend who apparently thought that George and Mitchell were a couple. The lesbian friend whose girlfriend Gail had got on surprisingly well with George on the road protest the other day. The lesbian friend to whom Annie was totally invisible. Literally.
Don't tell him, yeah? Kaz said to Mitchell. This is, like, personal. Okay.
Without waiting for an answer, she pushed past the still-boggling Mitchell and made a beeline for the kitchen doorway and George, who was walking into the living room. He stopped and let her hug him. There was an awkwardness to George in situations like this. Big, chunky, and just a little uncoordinated. Never mind the glasses and the sticky-out ears. George was like a kid who'd been brought up to require permission for everything. There was something simultaneously endearing and sad about it, Annie thought. George pulled back, looked down at the umbrella and then out of the door. It's not raining, he said.
I know.
Kaz rolled her eyes as George took the brolly from her and stood it in the corner.
Only I've just had my hair braided, see, and it's like, you know, when you have a perm and you mustn't get it wet or it'll all go.
She mimed a sudden explosive afro. Right, said George. Annie pulled a face, almost pleased that Kaz couldn't see her. She looked over at Mitchell. He was making frantic gestures at her and seemed to be mouthing, "What the hell's going on?" Annie shrugged and turned back to watch the show.
"Oh, I'd kill for a cuppa,"
Kaz said, shucking off her coat. It smelled of wet dog, despite being totally dry. Like the rest of Kaz's outfits is what she would have called charity shop chic. Annie would have said tramp. George handed it to Mitchell, who, holding it at arm's length, draped it over the back of a chair whilst George led Kaz across the lounge.
"I only drink herbal and fruit teas,"
Kaz called over her shoulder.
"Earl Grey with a splash of Ribena,"
whispered Annie to Mitchell. She followed the other two, leaving Mitchell to do the honours. With an unnecessarily loud, "Oof," Kaz fell back onto the sofa and began unbuttoning her cardigan. Annie spotted at least two more under there.
"Ah, you wouldn't believe what a day I've been having,"
said Kaz. She paused in her undressing and looked around the room.
"Oh, you should decorate in here."
"We should?" Mitchell asked. "And that's what you've come all this way to tell George, is it, Kaz?" George frowned.
"Mitchell, Kaz is our guest."
"You need to meet my friend Esme,"
Kaz barreled on, returning to the task of delayering herself.
"Like, she's only the best feng shui person in Bristol."
"And that's what we need, is it?" Mitchell asked. "Not to say you telling George was brought you here."
"Totally,"
Kaz shuddered exaggeratedly.
"This place is like..."
"Oh, that'll be me, I expect," Annie said, knowing full well that Kaz couldn't hear her.
"The resident undead."
She pulled a face.
"Maybe that's what's been keeping me here. The sofa's in the wrong place and we need a fish tank. Problem solved."
"Oh, there's a bad vibe here,"
Kaz continued.
"Not you too, obviously."
She looked around, eyes narrowed, as if searching for something. She hunched her shoulders.
"Unsettled? Yeah, definitely unsettled. Do you want Esme's number?"
"We'll have a think," George said. "Anyway, to what do we owe the pleasure?"
"Finally," breathed Mitchell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.